Violet, yeah, we see you. Thank you. Thank you for making your presence known and felt. For also, there's the session is being recorded and streamed live on YouTube. So, feel free to share the link with your colleagues who might not be able to join in on the meeting as it proceeds. We'll be beginning in the next 3 minutes. Yes. In the meantime, we have 1 more minute to go. Before we commence, I would like to pose a question to you, who are here. What do you know about first aid? Is it taught in your schools? Have you had training on it? Feel free to use the chat. The chat, you can issue a response through there, or you can unmute before you begin. Okay. The question was to before you comment, because the session we are having is on how to approach different communities on first aid. So you as the attendee here, what do you know about first aid? Has it been taught to you in school? Have you had previous training on it? Yeah, what do you know about first aid? Okay. So we have a response from Mohammed, says that first aid is all about to save life and prevent the condition from worsening. That is very correct. That is very, very correct, Mohammed. And Cherok Miri says that first aid is the first assistance given to a person with either minor or major injury to preserve life. Yeah, that is also correct. And yes, see, we are off to a running start. So if you're joining in, there's a question that I had posed on whether you are familiar with first aid, what you have learned about it so far, and whether it has been covered in your curriculum or if you've had training on it. What is first aid to you? Yes. And to kick start, I shall initially introduce myself, then proceed to introduce our speaker today. So my name is Victor Makumi. I am a third year medical student at Egerton University and a local officer for the Standing Committee for Medical Education. I also volunteer with St. John Ambulance, and I am a qualified first aider. Have been for nearly 6 years now. Yes. Our speaker today is Andrew Wanjohi. He has been a volunteer with St. John Kenya for over 20 years, and he is a training and development officer with St. John Kenya. He has experience in first aid and safety training in various setups and communities in Kenya. And he's also a good friend of mine. So, without much ado, I'd like to welcome Andrew to carry on.
Thank you, Victor. I don't need to introduce myself further than that. Host ameni mute
For
ataki niongee.
that, sorry for that.
Again, my name is Andrew Njohi. I'm a volunteer with St. John Ambulance. At the same time, I also train first aid and other safety and other short safety courses in what disaster preparedness, fire safety, and basically caring for the sick maybe while at home. So today we are here to discuss. Today we are here to talk about first aid training in, and I say, first aid training in the community. Now, the definition of a community is something that is subjective. Is it the school community? Is it in the rural areas, at home, workplace, in social gatherings and such? So first aid in general is first aid is first aid. And only two guys have answered my Nani Victor's question. Mohammed says that first aid is all about saving lives and preventing the condition from getting worse. Mary says that first aid is the first assistance given to a person with either minor or major injury to preserve life. So I want us to get into our session today. I hope as I share screen yangu kidogo. I hope you can see it, Victor.
Not yet.
You can't see the screen?
No. I see Cheryl's. Yes, now I can.
You can?
Yeah.
Aye, sasa. Now, first aid in the community. Our objectives for today is as maybe shared for me with me and generally for those people who train first aid is that at the end of our time together today for the next few minutes or hours that we're going to be together, you guys are going to understand the importance of community education on first aid skills. What are some of the few things that you can do to pass on skills to the communities? By communities here, we mean everything, everyone. School, work, home, the places of social gathering and such. And also, we are going to maybe learn a first aid skill. Here, one of the objective here is to try and understand what are the most important skills that we try to focus on when training guys in first aid. What are the things that do we encourage maybe teachers or even community educators to focus on when they are training people in first aid? So when it comes to first aid, apart from the definition that Mary Cherop has given us, first aid is the first assistance given to a person with either minor or major injuries to preserve life. Is there anyone with something else to add on to that? What else do you think first aid is about? What is your definition of first aid? If kwanza mtu aniambie, how do I translate first aid into Kiswahili? Hebu andika hapo definition yako ya first aid in Kiswahili. Tafsiri. Kitafsiri first aid into Swahili. What do you get? Hakuna mtu anajua kutafsiri first aid in Kiswahili. Aha, Jillian anasema usaidizi wa kwanza. Sawa. Victor anasema huduma ya kwanza. Mohamed anasema ajui. Sawa. Our definition of first aid, as people who train first aid, it is the initial kusaidia, violet, sijui kama nai pronounce vizuri, violet, Bikono says ni kusaidia. Yes, help, kusaidia. It is the initial assistance or help given to a casualty, using whatever material is available to you at that time, and generally accepted principles before handing over to a more responsible person. Now, who can tell me? You guys are medical students. So you've heard the word casualty, you've heard the word patient. Is there a difference? Is there a difference between a casualty and a patient?
Yeah.
Uh-huh, Tuambia. Useme tu yes, alafu unanyamaza. When you hear the word casualty, what we say is, I'm sorry if I'm I'm asking too many questions. This is how I do my sessions, interactively.
Casualty is someone who involved in an accident, something like that. And patient is like all casualty are patient, but all those who involve all casualty are not patient. Something like that.
Okay. So all casualties
are patients.
All casualties are patients, or is it the vice versa?
Evil.
Aye. Sasawa. Mohammed says that all casualties are patients, but not all patients are casualties. Can we say that a casualty is basically just someone who has suddenly been injured? A casualty is someone who has suddenly been injured or had suddenly fallen ill. So as a first aider, you are the first person to deal with them. You're the initial contact. The guys who maybe you're trying to reach out to train these skills, it's the initial contact, the guys who have the initial contact with that person who has been injured, someone has been involved in a road traffic accident, who's the first person at the scene? That is the first aider. But a patient is someone who's already receiving professional medical care. What now you guys aim to be at? You are going to be professionals in that field. So before that guy gets to you in the hospital, they should have received some form of care. And that is what many times makes a difference between now life and death. So here you are, the person at the hospital is the person who is now more responsible person. So our definition is that you use whatever material is available to you. If I could ask, how many of us have a first aid kit in the house or at our places of residence? How many of us have a first aid kit at our places of residence? Natukuona hata umeinua mkono. How many of us have a first aid kit? No one here has a first aid kit in their place of residence or in their house. Cheryl anasema tricky. Victor anasema yeah, konayo. Maybe I should rephrase that. At your place of residence, in your home, wherever, you have a pair of scissors. True, you have a you have cotton wool, you have spirit, you have antiseptic, you have pieces of cloth, handkerchiefs, and such. That is the material that is available to you. So that is your kit. That is what a first aider uses. Whatever material is available to them. Hi, Manir. Welcome. Jillian says she has something close to a first aid kit in the house. Yes, everyone does. Everyone does have something close to a first aid kit in the house. So you use whatever material is available to you, using whatever generally accepted principles that we do have. Let me see. We've all heard about the management of a nosebleed. If, for example, you were to start nosebleeding right now, what would you do? If you were to start nosebleeding right now, what would you do? Let me give you two options. Would you pinch your nose and lean back? Or would you pinch your nose and lean forward? Hey, I have another third option. Would you get a piece of cold cloth and place it at the back of your neck or on your forehead? Which one of those three would you do? Would you pinch your nose and lean back? Would you pinch your nose and lean forward? Or get something? Shamsuddin says the third option. Manir says pinch your nose and lean back. Jillian says 2 and 3. Lamech says pinch my nose and lean forward. So by generally accepted principles, we focus on what is the best practice out there and what is it that you guys should be going out to preach out there in the community. If someone is nose bleeding, we should all be doing the same thing. If someone is nose bleeding, someone should be pinching their nose, lean forward, and check every 10 minutes whether the bleeding has stopped. And that is the generally accepted principle for managing a basic nosebleed. There are various things that we have had. If someone is managing a burn, in a particular community, they will come and tell you, I want to place flour on the burn wound. Someone will come and tell you, let's use, what's it called? Now, those guys want to urinate on the burn. I think it's on the wound or on the burn. So there are various things. So which is the generally accepted principle? That's what you're supposed to be. That's the information you're supposed to be getting out there so that someone has the best possible chance of survival. Now, aims of first aid. Why do we need to teach first aid? You know, when you say that you want to go out there and sensitize the community on first aid, you need to understand what are your aims in training guys in first aid. What are our aims in training guys in first aid? And earlier, I think it was Mary Cherop who said that, not Cherop, but Mohammed Abdirizak says that first aid is to save life and prevent the condition from getting worse. Yes. Those are our main aims of first aid, to preserve life, to prevent the condition from getting worse, and to promote the casualties recovery. So what should we focus on when we are teaching first aid skills? What are the importance of first aid skills to the community? The importance of first aid skills to the community is a first aider assists the emergency services personnel when requested. If, for example, you want to maintain an open airway, a trained first aider doesn't need to be shown how to maintain an open airway. And they understand that that is a life-saving technique. So the emergency service personnel or even the professionals at the scene of an accident or incident know that, let me call this guy, he knows first aid. Let me call this guy, tell him maintain an open airway. That is assistance provided to the emergency services personnel. Then the importance of first aid skills. Assume that what happens is that some of the functions of the emergency services personnel following a disaster are assumed by first aiders. Why? Because in major incidents, the emergency service personnel may be overwhelmed. So guys in the community are the ones now who come in and say, we can be able to help. Without the proper skill, they may be more of, can I say, a barrier to help than a pathway to help. So you need to, that is the importance. You need to focus on the importance of, if you approach a certain particular institute, for example, a student's association, and tell them, guys, I want, over the next few weeks, we'll be taking sessions in first aid training. What is the importance of that? It's so that when the emergency service personnel are overwhelmed, whenever they're responding to something, there are people around who can still help and assume the functions of the emergency services. And then first aid skills helps to prepare families and communities in times of emergencies. where you're able to assist neighbors during an emergency, help first responders when they're not immediately available. Remember, especially in the country that we live in, first responders might not be readily available. So these first aid skills help to maintain, ensure that you save life and maintain that situation as it is before, without it getting worse. Until now, the professionals come in, or until guys in the community are able to take this person to a hospital. How am I able to help? If a road traffic accident were to occur, how will I be able to help? And am I prepared? What are some of the things that I'm prepared? I'm hoping that by the end of this session, the guys who are here will be able to know the importance of having a first aid kit in the house. Only one person has said they have a first aid kit in the house. Yet we get injured all the time, while at home, while in school, while at work, and such. So a first aid kit, basic first aid kit, goes a long way. So kuna, there's someone who said that she has something close to, yes, Jillian says that they have something close to a first aid kit. So get it even closer to a first aid kit. When we leave here today, I'm expecting that everyone here will be able to have something to do with, something to respond with in times of an injury or an emergency while at home. So when you're going out there to the community, if you want to approach a particular community, this are the things that you need to tell them are how their first aid skills will help in times of an emergency, be it a major incident or a small incident. How will they be able to assist in such a scenario? Then in a community setting, there are who we call community leaders. In your setting here, in the student association setting here, you have community leaders. Victor, how did you introduce yourself? You are the, is it chairperson or remind
local
me?
Officer.
Local officer for?
Standing Committee on Medical Education.
Yes, you are the local officer for the Standing Committee on Medical Education. So that is for that particular community, Cindy. For this particular community in this scenario. So there are community leaders, and the community leaders have a responsibility. They have a responsibility to participate in community preparedness. And this is one of those aspects where now your particular community leaders have said that we need to organize a session where guys can learn the importance of having, of sharing first aid skills with the community, and also learn what are the important first aid skills that they need to share with these guys in the community. So that's the responsibility of the community leaders, and get you together so that you can be able now to pass on the skills that you're learning at your institution, at your particular level. Community leaders also have a responsibility to participate in local collaborative planning councils. If a particular community has a disaster preparedness committee or an emergency preparedness committee, the particular community leader of that area has that responsibility. And maybe when you're approaching this community, these are the guys who you need to first approach, because they're the ones who are going to mobilize their community members to say that this particular group of students wants to train us in first aid. And this is a skill that is important. So when it comes from these guys, for example, we train boda boda guys in basic first aid skills, focusing on road traffic accidents. Now, if you want to gather boda boda guys, who do you go to? You go to their SACCO representatives and tell them that the SACCO chairperson, secretary, committee member, basically, you tell them that on this day, we are doing an awareness on handling road traffic accident victims. So get your guys, it's a 2-hour session, get your guys, and medical students will come and show you just basic techniques on how you can keep people alive in an emergency, how you can keep a scenario safe in an emergency. What are some of the things that we can do? You talk to the community leader that way, and he or she has a responsibility to ensure that they actually gather these guys so that we can say that, you know, you're bettering the community. The community leader also has a responsibility to identify and integrate the appropriate resources into government plans. The government has, a national disaster operations plan run through the National Disaster Operations Center and other agencies in that area, other emergency preparedness agencies, now where St. John comes in and such. So these are some of the things that you need to ensure that the community leaders understand. And they also need to ensure that their facilities, their staff, customers are served, the customers served are better prepared in cases of an emergency. If someone were to collapse when they're in the market, what do the people in the market do? Are they able to, is there anyone around who is able to assist? So that's the idea of what a community leader should be doing. Then what do the public have, or what is the responsibility of the public when it comes to this emergency preparedness skill in terms of first aid? As a member of the public, I have a responsibility to learn about community alerts. I have a responsibility to learn about warnings and evacuation routes that are available to me. In any institution, when you go into any institution, you have an emergency evacuation plan. And these are the things that maybe you need to look at when you say that, if there is a fire here, how do I know that there is a fire? You're going to hear a fire alarm. That's the warning. Oh, that's the alert. In the community, if there is a fire in the market, how do I learn that there's a fire in the market? People will start screaming. That is how you alert guys. Then as a member of the public, I also have a responsibility to get into training, just basic training in first aid. Take training in first aid and tell them that when you learn this skill, it may help save a loved one's life. Once they learn this skill, remember, why it's called a skill, it's because without practice, it is something that is perishable. It is something that someone will forget. So it is important that they need to practice this skill on a regular basis. So when you go out there, tell them, today I want us to learn how to bandage. Today I want us to learn how to tie a sling. And in general, that's going to help. Network, how you network now. For example, Victor is a member of St. John Ambulance. A volunteer. So through his volunteer network, he is able to learn this skill, practice this skill, and ensure that he helps others. It is your responsibility also to provide feedback and suspicious activity and volunteer. So as a member of the public, that is, as a member of the public, that is what is expected of you. So when you go out there, when you want to approach a community, first of all, community leaders. These are the guys who will help you mobilize. Once you approach the community leaders, identify what are their needs. What do they need to learn? what are some of the hazards that face them. You need to learn about that particular community. What are some of the hazards that face them? For example, if you go to somewhere, anyone here in Kenya, and tell them that because it's December, it's going to be snowing, there is a possibility of hypothermia, that's not a need that someone in the tropics need to learn about. So what else can they learn about? So focus your ideas on what these guys need to know, and make it sure that, again, I go back to the Boda Boda guys. This guy spends his time on the road. He is going to witness or even get involved in traffic accidents all the time. That is his main focus. So he needs to learn about how to handle fractures. He needs to learn how to handle bleeding. He needs to learn how to handle unconscious victims, head injuries, spinal injuries, such things. Those are the things that are important to him or her on the road. Then if it is someone who maybe has a school, who works in a school, what do they need to learn about? They need to learn about, if it is for young children, they need to learn about conditions that affect allergic reactions, medical conditions. They need to learn about fire safety precautions. Those are the things that you need to focus on training these guys. And from training yourself to training now members of the community. So yes, those are the responsibilities that you as a member of the public has. Now, we say that preparedness requires active participation from everyone. Active participation from everyone. So talk to friends first, your friends. Talk to your family about hazards at your workplace. And then find out about emergency planning outside the home. Where you are, in your various schools, do you have an emergency plan? In your various schools, do you have an emergency plan? Can I say, for example, If a fire were to occur in your school, let's talk about pre-COVID. Do you know about your emergency plan in the school that you're in? Let me select someone here. Fatima, I hope you can hear me. Fatima, now, do you know about the emergency evacuation plan in your institution? We've decided no. They do not. Victor says, one in case a fire struck. Yes. Now, basically, what I'm asking is, when you go out there, what do these guys have? What do Martha says no. She's not aware of any emergency evacuation plan that the institution may have. So what are some of the things that, first of all, it is familiarize yourself with them, and then talk to those who are in charge of having a plan, to create a plan in case someone were to collapse in your institution. What is the procedure? Who responds? Then the training that you share with them, the first aid skills provide training, practice, and a connection to others. You need to participate in drills and exercises that help to hone these drills. Then you need to talk to friends, and family about volunteering. That is what we mean by getting involved, and generally just ensuring that community members are aware of first aid skills and first aid preparedness and disaster preparedness. There. So far, are there any questions before I continue? Aye. Aye. Now, I want to play you something. I want to play you a video. Now, in this video, it's a road traffic accident. Lamek is asking, is a TLS part of first aid? Basic first aid skill, no. ATLS now is an advanced skill. ATLS is an advanced skill that a general first aider, or can I say the lay first aider, does not have. That's why it's called advanced trauma life support. Jillian is asking, fire extinguishers, there are some posters with some instructions on do's and don'ts in such scenarios. Yes, there are posters, even on fire extinguishers. Basically, a fire extinguisher has instructions on how to use it, so you just need to read the instructions and just follow the instructions. Is there any other question before I play you this? Let me just stop the share kidogo and get into my folder here. This is a video of a road traffic accident. Now, I want you guys to tell me if you were to maybe be the ones responding to such a scenario or training someone. But let me not say Manish says that they have fire extinguishers in their laboratories and lecture halls and in the institutions. Yes, that is true. Okay. Now, Jillian, you have a question? Hi. Now, I want you to watch this video, and I want you to come up with what are some of the problems that you identify in this scenario that would arise from such a scenario, and what would be a skill that would be important to share with people in such areas that have maybe such black spots and such. Let's just play this. I hope we can see. Victor, I hope you can see this.
I can.
So. Aye. So guys have responded to that scene. What do you think would be a good plan of action? You want me to play it for you guys again? What, maybe I should ask the question again. If the people who are around this incident were trained in first aid, what would they do? If the people who are around this incident were trained in first aid, what would they do?
I have an answer.
Same with Victor.
Okay, so they would follow a strategy called Omega. So they would assess the situation. And after assessing the situation, they make the area safe. Because this is a road traffic incident, by making the area safe, they could try stuff like ensuring that the engines of the various vehicles are turned off, and get ensuring that no bystanders come close to the incident because of the various risk factors that everyone may be exposed to. See, there's fuel leaking and it's ignited by a running engine, then there could be risk of an explosion which would result in further injury. So there is that. Then after making the area safe, you now get to call for help. This is where you call for first aiders or first responders to come to the scene. Yes. And if you're a first aider, you can be innovative and probably get one of the bystanders to help in something like crowd control. Because in such scenarios, there are people who seem to know more about the incident than those who were actually involved in the incident. So you can get them to help in making everyone calm down and get away from the area. Yes. Then after that, there is G. Oh, then aftermath now will follow. Yeah. So basically that.
Okay. Uh-huh. Sawa. That's how Victor would handle it. What do you think? You think that makes sense? I think it does. So let me just stop the share to Kidogo. Now, this is our incident. If guys are involved in a road traffic accident, they need to follow a certain plan of action. They need to follow a certain plan of action, which Victor has clearly illustrated for us. Assess, make the area safe, give emergency treatment, get help, aftermath. Now, you need to understand that in a particular community, there are different factors that you may come across. So what is it that you need to identify? You need to assess. So for example, when you assess the situation, what do you see? When you assessed that situation, you saw that it's a road traffic accident. It involves multiple vehicles, multiple casualties. There are casualties who need urgent evacuation to hospital. There are casualties who may be able to walk by themselves, so you can keep them in a safe distance. There are safety concerns. What are the safety concerns that you need to look out for? He's mentioned things about the possibility of a fire starting because the vehicle ignitions are on and such. So you need to share that information in terms of when you assess the situation, what are the things that you're looking at? When you make the area safe, what are the things that you need to do to make a scenario safe. So different scenarios have different ways in which you can handle them. So make the area safe or make the scene safe. Then give emergency aid to those who require it. Now, you guys are medical students. So in a scenario where I have 5 casualties, let me just even write them down upper so that I don't forget. I have five casualties. Casualty number one is a small child. Casualty number one is a small child seated on the pavement. He's crying for his parents. He's crying for his parents. That is person number two. Person number one. Person number two is a man who is screaming in pain because he has an open, He has an open fracture of the tibia. He is screaming in pain because he has an open fracture of the tibia. Casualty number three is a woman who is lying quietly on her back. She's not moving. Then person number four is a man who is lying quietly on his side. He's also not moving. And then we have a pregnant lady who has, we have a pregnant lady who's just gone into labor. That is number five. Number one, small child seated on the pavement crying for his parents. Number two, a man screaming in pain because he has an open fracture of the tibia. Number three is a woman who's lying quietly on her back. She's not moving. And number four is a man who is lying quietly on his side, not moving. Then we have number five is a pregnant lady who's just gone into labor. Who do you approach first?
I would say the woman who's lying quietly on her back and not moving. Because she seems unconscious, yeah.
So Samuel says that he would approach the woman lying quietly on her back who's not moving. Lamech also says number three. Noreen says number three and number four. Noreen, please choose one. you're solo. So number three. Are the reasons the same as what Samuel has just told us, that she seems unconscious? Gideon says number five, the pregnant lady who's just gone into labor. Gideon, why? Yours is the one that is unique. Why is it unique? Why would you approach the pregnant lady who has just gone into labor first? Noreen says three because of a probable spinal injury. Sawa. True. Gillian says because there are two lives on the line. Okay. Sawa, sawa. Now, what we are all doing is triage. Senor, we're just triaging our casualties. You're identifying who is the most important casualty to approach first and who's the least important. All that is part of first aid. So triaging is a skill that you need to share with the guys. If you're going to train someone on a first aid skill, you need to train them on priorities of triage. Who do I start with? Of course, you start with life-threatening conditions first. Your ABCs, we'll get into that. So those are the things that you need to start with. So triage is also a skill, and you categorize them. Who knows the categories of triage? If I may ask, is there anyone who knows about categorizing or triaging casualties or patients? We have colors. We have red. We have yellow. We have green. We have black. Yes, color coding, exactly. So you need to learn about the color coding in terms of the red, the yellow, the green, the black. Who falls into the red category? Who falls into the yellow category? Who falls into the green category? Who falls into the black category? Those are the things that maybe that's the information you need to share when you're giving emergency aid to those who need it at that moment. Give it to that person who has a life-threatening condition first, and then move on to the rest. If you're dealing with multiple casualties, and then get help. Get help from the emergency services. Get help from whomever. Where do they get help? When you're sharing information about getting help, where are these people getting help from? Do they have the emergency service numbers? Now, each and every county has a mandate of providing emergency medical service. So at the particular county that this person is based in that particular community, do they have access to the contacts of the emergency medical services? Okay, so those are the things that you need to share. You know, every county nowadays, unfortunately, if it is here in Kenya, unfortunately, we do not have a national or a single number where someone can call the emergency medical services. Yes, we do have a single number for the police, but for the emergency medical services and the fire service, we do not. For the police, who knows for the police? Remind me or remind me the number, the emergency number for the police, if someone knows it. Does any one of you know it? The emergency number for the police?
999.
Yes, Karen, thank you. 999. That's the emergency service. That's the emergency number for the police. Now, how many of us have the emergency services number, emergency medical service numbers, for example, for St. John, for example, for the Kenya Red Cross, for example, for your local county emergency medical service department? Do you have the number? Are you able to call them so that they can respond in case someone has been injured, someone has been hurt? What are the numbers you need to call? Okay, so it is important. This one I'm sharing for you, that one is for St. John Ambulance. In whatever county that they are found in, you can call that number. But it is important that you share that information. You just don't tell them, call an ambulance. Which ambulance are you calling? Okay, what is the importance of calling an ambulance? And what is the number? How do I call them? You know, those are the concerns that the community has. If I call the ambulance, how long will it take? Is it okay if I were to put my casualty in another vehicle and take them to hospital? Those are the concerns that you're going to be faced with in terms of this part for getting help in your incident management action plan. So you should always have an answer on This particular community I'm calling, these guys have an emergency number. I'm in Machakos County. We have an emergency medical team, emergency medical evacuation number that we need to call. This is the number. Share it with them. I'm in Mombasa County. This is what I am. This is the number that you need to call in terms of emergency medical services. So share that. And then now comes the aftermath. Aftermath here, as Victor mentioned, if you use the first aid kit, replace the equipment that you used, replenish your first aid kit. Where do they replenish their first aid kit if they do have a first aid kit? If they need to contact next of kin, please tell them that this is the information that you need to gather. Where, if this person was taken to a hospital, which hospital were they taken to? Who do they need to contact when they get there? So those are the things that you need to do after the incident. If it is an incident that required police involvement, who do they talk to in terms of the police? Where do the police come in? All that. That's information you need to share with the communities that maybe you're trying to approach to train in first aid. So this is your incident management action plan. Always share it. It works in all incidents, be it a major incident or a minor incident. We ask that it doesn't necessarily have to follow this procedure, but the first thing you need to do is assess, and the last thing you need to do is the aftermath. Here, in the thick of it, you may decide to call for help before you start giving emergency treatment. So that's really just up to the person giving help. So again, the information that you need to share when someone is calling for help, don't just call. Tell them, when you call an ambulance or when you call the fire brigade, tell them, give them an introduction. Tell them who you are. Give them a number. When you're introducing yourself, give them a number that they can call you with. Why are you calling? I'm calling because someone in my school has gone into anaphylactic shock and they have stopped breathing. Where is your school? Give them an exact location. Use common road names, landmarks. Use landmarks. Don't just tell them, karibu na duka ya M-Pesa. Where is that? Okay? So use common road names. When you're giving an exact location, then say what you need. Tell them that please send an ambulance to take this casualty to hospital, or take my friend to hospital. Confirm that your message is clear. You need to confirm that your message is clear. This guy may have had different information than what you wanted to share. So please confirm that your message is clear and the time it's going to take for them to get to you. Remember, that response time is something that guys are always worried about. That's why you find that so many victims of road traffic accidents, especially, are just bundled into a vehicle and the vehicle owner is told, take this guy to hospital. Now, this time is important so that you can know, these guys I'm calling, okay? Am I able to wait for them? Should I look for an alternative? Now, we emphasize that it is important if someone has access to an ambulance service, it is important that they wait for the ambulance service. It's much easier for the ambulance personnel to hand over a patient to a hospital than just a private citizen who brought this casualty using private means. And maybe it's not even their relative. They're just saying that they are a good Samaritan who decided. Abdurruf is saying that he has an issue with volume. Is that just him or Victor? You also have a Victor. Tell me, because now you're my sounding board. You're the one who's telling me whether my volume is okay or not.
I can hear you fine.
Oh, okay. Abdurruf, your advice to call via the internet by Jillian. Now, where were we? Yes, 4WCT. This is information you need to share with. This is information you need to share with the guys. You need to tell them that keep your phone call brief. Say who you are, why you're calling, where you're calling from, what you need from this guy. Confirm that the message is clear and the time it will take for these guys to get to you, so that you can decide whether it is okay, I can wait for these guys, or I can now look for an alternative. So yes, 4WCT. So on incident management, that is the information you need to share, because people at the community level usually don't understand how to manage a particular incident. But once they learn how to manage an incident, that is information you need to focus. That is the important or the importance of learning a skill, in so that at the end of your session with them, they are able to manage an incident effectively and efficiently. So that if anything were to happen to anyone in that particular community, there are people who are there who are able to respond to that. And that is some information that would be useful in any scenario, in any setting. Guys know how to respond to an incident. Guys know how to manage an incident. Guys know who to call in case the incident escalates, or if they need help and such. So yes, that is information that you need to share with your community. And that is the importance of learning the incident management action plan. Are there any questions up to that point? Hi. If there are no questions from at this moment now, I want us to get into learning the important skill of managing a casualty. So one of our objectives today was someone needs to learn a first aid skill. So I'm going to share with you three skills in first aid very quickly. I'm going to deliver them, and you're going to see whether it is something that you can teach someone. The idea of a first aid skill is keeping it very basic. Remember, when you're going out there into the community, you're not going to teach someone about the anatomy. Okay, in-depth trying to name all the muscles in the body. No, it is basically managing your casualty. So, yes, thank you, Jillian. There's a point that you're mentioning about maneuvering through the traffic is very hectic. So an ambulance has a siren. So when guys hear a siren, they just allow the ambulance to pass. By the time you're being allowed to pass with your hazard lights on, you'll have a very huge problem. So casualty management. Now, I already mentioned something about this. When you're managing a casualty, even in the hospital, I'm sure this is the first thing that you were taught when you got into school. There are three key aspects: protecting the airway, managing breathing, and circulation. Ensure that the casualty's airway is open, breathing is present and normal, and blood is circulating as it should. A, B, C. These are our life-threatening priorities. If someone forgets all the first aid that they are taught, all the medical knowledge that they are taught, you're going to back to basics. Basics is airway, breathing, circulation. Does my casualty have a clear airway? Yes. Is my casualty able to breathe normally? Yes. Is the heart circulating blood as it should be? And the blood is not leaking in terms of they're not bleeding? Yes. Then beyond that, that is secondary to this. So manage airway, check breathing, and circulation. Manage all these three. These are the three key aspects. When someone is out there in the streets and they're having a medical problem. Airway, breathing, and circulation. Now, what happens is that when someone has an obstructed airway, we go back now to the five casualties that I gave you. When someone is lying on their back, they have a possibility of having a blocked airway. Why? Because if someone is unconscious, their muscles relax. That includes the tongue. The tongue falls back, blocks the airway, and air is unable to get into the lungs. So you can teach this guy a very basic maneuver: head tilt, chin lift. What this does is it lifts the tongue away from the airway. So tilt the head back and lift the chin. That is how you open the airway. Now, if your casualty has a head injury or a possible spinal injury, there is another maneuver that we call the jaw thrust. When it comes to the jaw thrust, that keeps the spinal cord as straight as possible, but it achieves the same objective without having to curve this neck. I'll play you a video later on. So those are the two skills on opening an airway. Head tilt, chin lift, that's the easiest one. And the jaw thrust. Thrust the jaw open so that you can maintain an open airway. Now, for all casualties that you come across out there in the streets or in the community or wherever you find a casualty, where it's not a hospital setting, you must do a primary assessment or a primary survey. Primary survey entails checking for danger, checking for response, opening the airway, check whether the casualty is breathing, and confirm that the heart is beating. So check danger. Is there anything dangerous that could cause harm to this casualty? Response. Ask the casualty, hello, can you hear me? Open your eyes if you can hear me. This is just a very basic, way to check for the levels of response. There are four levels of response that we check for. Is your casualty alert? Is your casualty responding to voice commands? Is the casualty responding to painful stimulus? Or is your casualty unresponsive? Those are the four levels of response we look at when you're doing a primary assessment. Now, if your casualty is unresponsive, open the airway. Open the airway by tilting the head back, like I've seen in the previous slide, and check whether the casualty is breathing. How do you check whether the casualty is breathing? By looking at the rise and the fall of the chest. Very quickly, you can even place your hand on the casualty's stomach and see whether the hand rises and falls as the casualty breathes. So you do this for 10 seconds. Check for breathing, do this for 10 seconds. And then quickly check the pulse, check for circulation. I'm sure we all know where to check for pulse, but I want us to check for pulse right now. That's an exercise I want us to do to see whether we can check for pulse. Now, as a first aider, you check for pulse. We focus on two areas, at the neck and at the wrist. What's the pulse at the neck called? Someone remind me. What's the pulse at the neck called? Yes, the carotid. Now, using these three fingers, using your three fingers, I want you to check the pulse at the carotid. Yes, thank you, Ahmed, the carotid pulse. I want us to check our pulse right now. I'm going to time you, okay? I'm going to time you, and all you need to do is tell me all you need to do is tell me what your pulse rate is. So is everyone checking? I hope everyone is checking their pulse. I'm going to tell you when to start and when to stop. Aye. We're going to start in a few minutes, in a few seconds, in 3, 2, 1, start counting. Stop. Aye. Tell me your pulse rate.
17 beats per second.
17 beats per second. We've checked for 10 seconds. So it's 17 beats per 10 seconds. Karen has 17 beats per 10 seconds. Samuel has 15 beats per 14 seconds. Okay. Uh-huh. Someone else? Someone else who checked their pulse? I want us to check our pulse again now at the wrist. I want us to check the pulse at the wrist. Where do we check the pulse at the wrist? We check the pulse at the wrist using the thumb. And Lamek has 13, Victor has 12. So I want us to compare with the one at the neck. So I want us to check the pulse at the wrist, and then you're going to tell me whether it's within normal range. Please wait for me to tell you to when to start counting and then when to stop counting. Sawa, we are about to start. So Sawa, we are about to start counting in 3, 2, 1, go. Stop. All right, how many do we have at the wrist? The radial pulse. What do we have with the radial pulse? What do we have with the radial pulse? What do we have with the radial pulse? Victor has 12, Samuel has 13. Lamek has 12, Ahmed has 12, Cheryl has 12. Karen has 14. Mary has 13. Violet has 13. So remember, as first aiders, we record the pulse rate per minute. So we record the pulse rate per minute. So for you to get, Jillian has 10. Why are you worried, Jillian? We record the pulse rate per minute. So Amna has 12. So for you to get the pulse rate per minute, since we've checked for 10 seconds, multiply that number by 6 and you will get the pulse rate per minute. So for example, Amna has 12. So in a minute, that's 72 beats per minute. Is that within normal range? Jillian has 10. So in a minute, that's 60 beats per minute. Violet and Cherop have 13. In a minute, that's what, 78 beats per minute. So is that within normal range? Yes, that's within normal range, because normal range for an adult who is resting should be between 60 and 100 beats per minute. So as first aiders, that's just some of the basic information that you need to share. Is the pulse rate within normal range? If it is slower than 60, that's a slow pulse. If it is faster than 100, that is a rapid pulse. So when you're describing the pulse, those are the things that you need to look out for. Is your pulse within normal range? Normal range being between 60 and 100, or is your pulse slow? That's slower than 60. Is it rapid? That's faster than 100 beats per minute. So once you conclude your primary survey, now in circulation also please check whether there are any pools of blood. Is there an area where you see massive or catastrophic bleeding? That is also a life-threatening condition. That bleeding needs to be controlled as a matter of urgency. So once you conduct your primary survey and maybe your casualty does not have any life-threatening condition in terms of airway breathing and catastrophic bleeding, conduct a head-to-toe survey. Basically, this is assessment for other injuries, where you're going to use your hands and your eyes to check whether the casualty has any injuries that you may not appear immediately. So we conduct a head-to-toe survey. You gather information from the casualty. Now, don't always think about massive incidents. There are small incidents involving medical conditions where you need to gather history. So external clues could help. Things like medication that the casualty may have could help you understand what this casualty may be going through. And then what are the signs and symptoms? What are the signs and symptoms for the casualty? So do a secondary assessment. Now, what are some of the questions? I want us to look at two scenarios when we're doing a secondary assessment. You need to collect a sample history. And then if your casualty is unconscious, do a head to toe and maintain an open airway. So sample history, signs and symptoms. You ask the casualty about what they are feeling. Who can tell me what the difference between a sign and a symptom is? Who knows what the difference between a sign and a symptom is?
You can see a sign, like a road sign or something that someone is exhibiting, but a yes. symptom can only be expressed by the person experiencing it.
Exactly. So symptoms are felt. So what the patient says they are feeling. Yes. Thank you, Noreen. Thank you, Jillian. Thank you, Victor. Yes. So ask questions. What do you feel? Yes. Allergies. Is your casualty allergic to anything? Medication. Is your casualty on any medication? For example, if someone is on insulin, you know that they are diabetic. If someone has what aspirin on them, they may have. If someone has aspirin on them, they may have a heart condition. Martha says a symptom is what is told in history, while signs are what is seen in a physical exam. Thank you. That is exactly it. Then ask about past history, past medical history. If someone starts complaining of pain in the chest, and then they tell you that 6 months ago they suffered a heart attack, that should tell you something. Then last oral intake. When is the last time this person ate? Because if you find someone collapse, they have fainted. Someone has fainted. Why have they fainted? Because they have not eaten. So what do they need? They need sugar. So when is the last time that this person ate? And what are the events that led to this casualty being this way? So collect a sample history. And then if your casualty is unconscious, gather the external clues that you may gather. After a head-to-toe survey, place your casualty in the recovery position. The main aim of the recovery position is to maintain an open airway. That is lying on their side. Lying on their side to allow the tongue to fall onto their side so that it does not block the airway. This is a very basic skill that you can teach someone and they learn immediately. And it is an important skill because like university students, people want to go out, have fun, drink and black out. They black out, someone is lying on their back and they can very easily vomit. They vomit that vomit can come and block their airway. So a basic skill is the recovery position. Turn them onto their side, leave them there, so that even if they were to vomit while they were unconscious, that fluid could easily drain out. So this maintains an open airway and it allows for free flow of fluids out of the mouth, just in case someone were to vomit while they were unconscious. And that helps to maintain an open airway and maintain breathing also at a normal level. So let me just play you a video of someone being placed in the recovery position so that you can see what I'm talking about. Is that recovery position? Thank you. Someone has a question. Mawada Mohammed has a question, but we can't hear you very clearly. Mawada, we can't hear you very clearly. If you have a question, try and type it out on the chat. Meeting host. Thank you.
We've done a primary survey and established that Alkazole is unconscious, but they're breathing normally. They must be placed into the recovery position to maintain the airway. What we're going to do is take the hand that's nearest to us and move it out of our way, right angles to the body, palms uppermost. Draw the hand that's furthest away from us across the body. We're going to hold it against your cheek. Grab hold of the leg away from us by the knee, drawing it up, making sure that the foot is flat on the floor. We are then going to roll the person towards us while we protect their head. Take our hands away, readjust the airway. Then we're going to bring the leg uppermost to right angles to the body. The other leg, very importantly, must be straightened. We're going to check for severe bleeds. And once we've completed that, we're going to make sure that we've got our arms on the way, and then we can actually just stay and monitor the person. And that's how you perform the recovery position.
So yes, that's how we perform the recovery position. That's how we perform the recovery position. So we look at it this way. We combine the primary survey and the secondary survey, and we look at it like this. If your casualty, check for danger, check for response. If your casualty is unresponsive and you're alone, shout for help. Open the airway, check breathing. Breathing is present, check pulse. Do a secondary survey, then place your casualty in the recovery position, then go for help, send for help, or call for help. That's how you handle an unconscious casualty who is breathing. That is the first skill. Are there any questions? Aye. The next skill is, Jillian, could there be a specific reason as to why the recovery position is on the left side as per the video? There are specific guys who we look at when it comes to the side with which you place them. Otherwise, the recovery position is on any side. But we turn the casualty onto the left side if you're dealing with a lady who is pregnant, or if someone has an injury to their chest. They're unconscious and they also have an injury to their chest. So you place the injured side lowermost to avoid stressing the uninjured lung. It aids in easier breathing. So onto the left side is for a lady who is pregnant because the blood vessels that feed the lower limbs and the fetus run along the right side, and you do not want to cause pressure on them. So place them on the left side. But for the rest of the casualties, you can just place them on any side, unless now they have an injury to the chest, which may require you to turn them onto the side that is injured. Hope that answers you. Hi. If you're dealing with an unconscious casualty who is not breathing, if you're dealing with an unconscious casualty who is not breathing, we have something we call CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation. Cardiopulmonary resuscitation is given to a casualty who is not breathing, who has gone into cardiac arrest. If a casualty is not breathing, you give them air pump blood. Chest compressions through chest compressions and artificial ventilations. I think all of you know how the aspect of pumping blood with oxygen works. Just an overview. Your body's vital organs require oxygen. Generally, your body requires oxygen to stay alive. So the pumping of the heart is what now circulates that oxygen through the blood circulating. So where do you get this oxygen? From the air that you breathe. The air that you breathe outside contains around 21% of oxygen. When it gets into the lungs, it is absorbed by the blood, gets into the heart, and the heart now pumps it through the blood vessels. That's the arteries, the veins, and the capillaries. Now, anatomy tu kidogo. The arteries carry blood away from the heart. The veins carry blood towards the heart. That's what the circulation is about. The arteries carry oxygenated blood apart from the pulmonary artery. And the veins carry deoxygenated blood, apart from the pulmonary vein. The reason behind that is that the pulmonary artery is carrying blood away from the heart towards the lungs so that it can collect oxygen. And then the pulmonary vein is carrying that oxygenated blood from the lungs to the heart so that it can be pumped to the rest of the body. That is how blood circulates. Now, if someone is not breathing, and their heart is not pumping, all that is not happening. It means that the brain will start to, brain cells will begin to die if they do not receive oxygen. And there's a 4-minute window. If after 4 minutes, within 4 to 6 minutes, brain cells do not receive oxygen, they begin to die. And that is the reason why CPR is an important skill for you to share with others or with members of the public. Chest compressions and artificial ventilations. Now, nowadays, because of COVID, we do not do mouth to mouth unless you have a ventilation device. You do not do mouth to mouth. But the algorithm for CPR is 30 chest compressions and 2 artificial ventilations, and keep repeating. 30 compressions at the center of the chest. You place the heel of your hand at the center of the chest and pump 30 times. And then if you have the right equipment that I'm talking about is a bag valve mask, BVM. If you have a BVM, give ventilations. But if you do not have that, just do chest compressions only in this day and age of COVID. So what we do, give chest compressions, give artificial ventilation. This is the algorithm. 30 compressions, 2 ventilations. 30 compressions, 2 ventilations. Repeat. And let's look at how it works. We said you must conduct a primary survey. That is where you're going to discover your casualty is not breathing. So check for danger, check for response. Open airway, check breathing. Breathing is absent. The moment you discover that someone is not breathing, send for help immediately. The moment you discover that someone is not breathing, send for help immediately. And then start compressions and artificial ventilations. Start compressions and artificial ventilations. And that's how you assist someone who is not breathing. Now, if again I say, emphasize, because of the era that we live in, because of the era that we live in terms of COVID, you do chest compressions only. You do chest compressions only, CPR. Let me share a video on chest compressions only, CPR.
Mm-hmm. My name is Vinnie Jones, and I'm going to teach you a lesson you'll never forget. There are times in life when being tough comes in handy. Say some geezer collapses in front of you. What do you do? We need a volunteer that ain't breathing. Here's one I made earlier. First thing you do is you check him over. If he ain't responsive or he ain't breathing, or he's making noises like this, then his heart will stop working, he's having a cardiac arrest. Look lively. First call 999. Then you do hands-only CPR and no kissing. You only kiss your missus on the lips. Watch, lock your fingers together, knuckles up, then push down, right on the sovereign. Push down 5 or 6 centimetres. That's about 2 inches in old money. Push hard and fast, about 2 times a second, like to the beat of staying alive. Worried you'll hurt him? Better a cracked rib than him kicking the bucket. Keep this up till the ambulance arrives. So don't forget, check him over. Call 999, push hard and fast to staying alive. It works. Hands only CPR. It ain't as hard as it looks.
Yeah, so that's hands only CPR. That's hands only CPR, and it's a very simple skill that you can share with your casualty. So remember, CPR goes on. CPR goes on until these 5 aspects are achieved. Until help arrives, or until the casualty starts to breathe on their own, or you're too exhausted to carry on. So that you don't get exhausted, it's important that every 2 minutes you switch if you have someone who can assist. And then if the scene is no longer safe, take your casualty, drag your casualty to a safer location. And then again, on physician's orders, if you guys order someone to stop CPR, then they will stop CPR. Now, if you're alone, try and do 2 minutes of resuscitation. 5 cycles is 2 minutes of resuscitation before going for help yourself. If you're dealing with a child in first aid is 1 to puberty. Do the sequence using only one hand. If you're dealing with an infant, use only 2 fingers. And generally just follow the chain of survival. The chain of survival says that the moment you discover your casualty is not breathing, call for help. So early access to help. Then start CPR immediately. Now, if you have access to a defibrillator, which the lay person in the community doesn't really have. So if you have access to a defibrillator, an AED, an automated external defibrillator, you can use that. Whereas since this is community first aid and such, these guys probably don't have access to a defibrillator. Then early advanced care. So are there any questions on CPR? Aye. Na nasema kuna swali. Ahmed says also there's no question. Aye. Now, we said that the other skill we want to, there are 3 skills that I want you to learn today. So choking is a problem with the airway. If your casualty is choking, it means that they have an obstruction of the airway, partially or completely, by a foreign object. So how do we handle this person? Encourage them to continue coughing. encourage them to continue coughing. If that doesn't help, give up to 5 back blows. Between the shoulder blades, just give up to 5 back blows. If that doesn't help, give up to 5 abdominal thrusts. And keep alternating. By abdominal thrusts, the Americans call it the Heimlich maneuver. So give up to 5 abdominal thrusts. Keep alternating the blows with the thrust. So encourage them to continue coughing, then give up to 5 back blows. If that doesn't work, give up to 5 abdominal thrusts. If that still doesn't work, go back to the blows. So keep alternating the blows with the thrusts until the obstruction clears or the casualty falls unconscious. If they fall unconscious, what do? We start CPR. Check airway, check breathing, start CPR, because it's highly likely they will have stopped breathing. Excuse me. So if you're dealing with this casualty, this is how you position yourself. Behind your casualty, support them, then using the heel of your hand between the shoulder blades, and just go ahead and smack their back. If that doesn't work, locate the navel. Just above the navel, do up to 5 abdominal thrusts. That is how you position yourself. If you're dealing with an infant, give up to 5 back blows. If that doesn't work, give up to 5 chest thrusts. So if you're dealing with an infant, give up to 5 back blows. If that doesn't work, give up to 5 chest thrusts. And keep alternating until the obstruction clears or your casualty falls unconscious and they stop breathing. So you start CPR. Again, if you're dealing with an expectant lady, give chest thrusts. Because of obvious reasons, you cannot give abdominal thrusts. Again, also, you cannot give back blows. You cannot give back blows because you can't lean them forward far enough. So give chest thrusts until the obstruction clears, as clearly illustrated in this photo here. So give chest thrust until the obstruction clears or your casualty becomes unconscious. And if they become unconscious, we said you start CPR immediately. So that's choking for you. That's how you handle choking very fast. And wait, I have one more skill also. Sorry. Are there any questions on choking? Aye, no questions. So finally, when we're dealing with out there, bleeding is a very common occurrence. So when you're dealing with severe bleeding, this is our focus. Expose the wound, examine the wound, apply pressure on the wound, elevate the wound, cover the wound, and treat for shock. I think we all know what shock is. Do we? We all know what shock is. Let me play you a video of severe bleeding and so that you can see what I mean. When you're teaching now guys first aid, this is just the basic skill that you tell them that you need to expose the wound, you need to examine the wound, apply pressure, elevate, cover, treat for shock. Then show them how to do this. So I want us to, I want to share a video on how to handle severe bleeding. The severe bleeding that I have here is an amputation.
Knowing what to do if a casualty has a complete or partial amputation may save the casualty's life and limb. If the amputation is complete, cover the wound with a pad of dressing and apply direct pressure over the wound. Compare circulation in both limbs. Secure the dressings in place using a roller bandage. Anchor the bandage at the wrist and wrap it over the top of the amputation so pressure is applied directly over the wound. Continue wrapping the roller bandage firmly with even pressure. The bandage should be applied tight enough to control bleeding, but not so tight as to cut off circulation to the hand. Tape the end of the bandage in place. Reassess circulation in both hands. Wrap the amputated part in a clean dressing. Place it in a plastic bag. Moisten the dressing. And place the bag on ice to keep the finger cool. Label the bag with the name and time. If the amputation is partial, bring the partially amputated part back into its normal position. Cover the wound with a pad of dressings and apply direct pressure. A partially amputated part may have poor circulation due to the injury. Check circulation in the partially amputated part and again after bandaging. Secure dressings in place using a roller bandage. Anchor the bandage at the wrist and wrap around the finger to provide direct pressure at the injury site. Make sure the bandage is tight enough to control bleeding, but not so tight as to cut off circulation to the hand. Continue wrapping the roller bandage, maintaining an even pressure. Tape the bandage in place and compare the circulation in both hands and in the partially amputated part.
So that is how you handle severe bleeding. First, deal with the blood, deal with the bleeding by applying pressure immediately, covering the wound, and then treating for shock. Here, I mean, we need to cover the casualty and keep them warm. You cover the casualty and keep them warm. That helps in improving circulation. And generally, that is all I have for you today. Are there any questions? Hi, if there are no questions, hand you over back to Victor.
Thank you, Andrew, for that very enlightening session. And first aid has a lot more to dive into than that. So I pose a challenge to everyone here to make an attempt to try and get more knowledge, or to at least get a first aid manual. It looks something like this. Yeah. If you go through that, you can be very much adept. Thank you, Andrew, for the session. I see people are commenting in the group. Cheryl says that was amazing, and indeed it was, and very, very creative. The video illustrations also made it more and more interactive and put things into better perspective. Then Cherub Mary says, wow, thank you very much. The presentation was awesome. I'm motivated. I'm just requesting if the slides could be shared. I guess, Andrew, would it be possible to share the slides? Then I could be able to distribute them. Yeah.
So I'll send them to you. I'll send the comprehensive. That was a very brief thing. So I'll send you the comprehensive one.
Okay, so I shall have my number here. So reach out to me and I'll share the slides to you as soon as Andrew will send them to me, then I'll share them to you if you need of them. Yes. So if there are no further questions, I wonder whether Cheryl has anything to say before we conclude.
I don't have much to say other than thank you so much, Mr. Andrew, for taking your time on a public holiday to come and share your expertise with us. And I've really learned a lot personally, and will definitely be using this and sharing this with my family and friends. So thank you so much for that amazing session. And thank you to Victor for moderating the session. Thank you so much for taking up the task and doing it very well. And I'd also like to thank the participants for joining today. Thank you all for taking your time to be here and being here. This is our final session on the community crash course training. So if you would like to check out the other three, you can always just go to the Msake YouTube page and you'll find them all there. And yes, you will be getting your certificates in your emails this week. So yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Cheryl. And thank you all for attending, for making time to be here. And happy Jamhuri Day to all of you from Kenya, just in case we have people who are present and not from around here. Yes. So with that, you are now free to live at your own leisure, and yeah, we call this. We shall end the session now. Yes. Have a lovely evening.
Thank you. Let's go watch football now. Manchester being kicked out.
Thank you, Mr. Andrew. Have a lovely weekend.
Hi, Karibuni. Happy Jam Holiday to you.
Thank you.